Hi, everyone. Welcome. I'm Mike Fisher. I'm the CTO here at Etsy, and welcome to Coder's Craft, everyone here, as well as everyone who's live streaming. It's my pleasure this evening to introduce our guest speaker, Liz Fong-Jones. Liz is a staff site reliability engineer at Google and works on the Google Cloud Customer Reliability Engineering team in New York. She has worked across 8 different teams spanning the stack from Google Flights to Cloud Bigtable in her 10-plus years at Google. She lives with her wife, Metamore, and Samoyed Golden Retriever Mix in Brooklyn. In her spare time, she plays classical piano, leads an EVE Online Alliance, and advocates for transgender rights. Tonight, she's going to be speaking to us about adopting SRE and error budgets. And I'm super excited about this presentation because we've had the pleasure at Etsy of working with some Google CREs and SREs lately, because we've got a little cloud project going on. So we've had the pleasure of that. And also, the whole concept of SRE is very in line with Etsy. We've been empowering engineers to build and own systems for many years. It's part of our culture. And so the concept of SRE from Google just fits perfectly with that. And so I'm excited, as I'm sure everyone here is, to learn a lot more about it. And so if you're interested in how we work, definitely find someone in a black shirt, Coder's Craft shirt, and ask us about Etsy. We're hiring across all of our engineering teams. And with that, I'd like to introduce Liz. Please join me in welcoming.
Thank you so much for having me. I hope that everyone can understand me clearly, even in the back. Yes? Great. Fantastic. So, as you mentioned, I'm Liz Fong-Jones, and I'm a developer advocate and site reliability engineer on Google Cloud. And today I wanted to kind of warm you all up by thinking about what things make us nervous about reliability. Kind of what are the challenges that we're worried about when trying to operate services in a public cloud? I'll maybe take some audience participation. I'll repeat back so everyone can hear what people have said. Someone, what's a concern that you might have about reliability? Yes, the site might be down. Yes, back there.
Scaling?
Yes, you're worried about scaling. You're worried that your site isn't going to work correctly when you scale up.
Network latency.
Network latency, yes. And especially network latency when you have a cloud provider who's providing your network and not your own on-premises data center networks. Take a couple more. One over there.
Losing money.
Losing money, yes. If your site isn't working, then you might be losing money, or even worse, people might demand refunds for you if they're paying you for a service. Two more. Let's take one back there.
Surge of traffic.
Yes. Scaling it in response to a short-term demand rather than a long-term demand. And final one back there.
Losing data.
Yes, you're worried about your data integrity, right? Like, you're worried that your services aren't going to be able to serve the data that you entrust with them. So these are all very, very common concerns that we hear a lot from our customers, which essentially boil down to, how do I know whether things are working appropriately, and how do I react when things aren't working according to how I plan? So today I want to talk about 5 subjects. First of all, I want to spend a little bit of time telling you about what problem SRE and DevOps solve, and how we define SRE and DevOps. We're going to talk about what a service level objective is, and how it can help you in achieving your reliability goals, how to pick an appropriate service level objective, and then once you have one, how do you actually run to that specification? How do you actually manage the control loop of your service so it runs at an appropriate level of reliability? And then finally, we'll talk about how this actually can make your site more able to tolerate faster feature deployments, more able to go faster. So to start off with, kind of, I wanted to provide a little bit of background of what background am I coming at you from? Kind of, how might my expectations be different from or the same as yours? So I've spent over 10 and a half years as a site reliability engineer, and I've worked on all kinds of different teams. I've worked on teams that did everything from low-level data storage, where kind of storing those bits is our job, all the way up to high-level things like Google Playbooks or Google Flights, where we are serving user-facing interactive queries directly to users on the public internet. And today what my focus is on is helping teach people who are outside of Google, right? Helping teach people that are trying to run on a public cloud what it's going to take in order for them to be successful. So let's start off talking about what is SRE, why does it matter? And I think the key point here is that when you have a service that you're developing, what happens is that you think you're done when you spend a month developing a feature, but it winds up being the case that you spend another month of your time or someone else's time supporting it once it reaches production. And that's the bare minimum. In many cases, it can take 10 months of support time to support your service in production over its lifetime compared to the 1 month it took to develop it. That's a little bit scary, right? That you think you're done, and you're not actually done. So if we can do things in order to reduce the cost to run your service at the appropriate level of reliability, that's going to dramatically decrease the total cost that it takes you to operate your software over its total life cycle. And why is this so expensive? A lot of this is because of the fact that we haven't necessarily done this well in the past as people who operate software, as people who build software. Because if you have a situation where you have developers who are focused on product agility, who are focused on trying to release features as quickly as they can, and then you have a separate team of operators who are in charge of maintaining the stability of the service, who are in charge of saying, you know, I don't think that this should ship because I'm tasked with making it as reliable as possible. And those two people, two sets of people, come from different backgrounds. For instance, you might have people who are software engineers on one side, and you might have sysadmins on the other side who don't necessarily use the same languages, who don't necessarily have the same, same educational backgrounds, right? That results in a lot of friction. That results in a lot of people arguing, and that results in a lot of wasted time and a lot of wasted energy. And this is a problem that we know to some extent how to solve, right? In that, in the past 10 years, 15 years, we've discovered that it's better to break down the silos between different parts of your business. For instance, to break down the silo between product management and your product development software engineers, and also to break down the silos between development and operations. So Agile and DevOps really focus on solving this problem of how do we actually make our services reliable enough while keeping our agility, while keeping our ability to communicate with each other. And in a nutshell, what we understand DevOps to be essentially is these five things. That we need to reduce these organizational silos. That we need to say, you know what? It doesn't really matter trying to prevent failures. We'd rather reduce the time to recover from failures. That we should implement gradual changes, for instance, by doing iterative development or reducing the cost of deploying each change. And that we need to have tooling and automation in order to be able to accomplish this. And at the end of the day, measurement is the critical piece of knowing what are your key performance metrics, and are they getting better, or do you need to rethink what you're doing? So in parallel with the DevOps movement evolving over the past 15 years, Google had the same problem of encountering a situation of needing to run large-scale systems as efficiently as possible. And what SRE settled on at Google was the idea that we also need to use data on reliability to guide our decision-making, and that we also need to use automation. That we need to treat operations fundamentally as a software engineering problem rather than as a separate discipline from software engineering. And that means that when we hire people into SRE at Google, what we wound up doing was that we wound up hiring people that had some amount of software development experience in order to be able to work on building these systems that could heal themselves. And not only that, but not bolting on automation after the fact, but instead making sure that we design our systems right from the start so we don't wind up having to rethink and rework things after they're already deployed. So I'm not necessarily going to have time to go into detail about all of these SRE practices, but I wanted to give you a little bit of flavor for the first four and then talk in a lot more detail about the last one. So we think it's important that organizations that are practicing any kind of mature operational skill set, even if they don't call themselves SRE, need to do these five things. That you need to think about, how can I observe my system? How can I measure what's going on inside of my system? Can I capacity plan? Do I know how much my service is going to cost to run? And do I have communications with my cloud provider about whether or not the cloud provider can tolerate rapid changes in capacity? Do I have a robust change management process? Do I have some mechanism of making sure that the changes that I push are going to be reliably pushed and that they're not going to have a high failure rate and failure to deploy? And do I have a healthy emergency response culture? Do I have the ability to fix things under pressure, or does my organization have fragility when there is an actual outage? Are people arguing with each other and not actually fixing the problems? But I think that the most important thing of all five of these things is the culture. And that's what I'm going to focus on when I talk about what fundamentally makes for an SRE organization. The first key thing is that blamelessness is really, really important. That you can't fix people. Because people are human, people are inevitably going to make mistakes, and no amount of yelling at a human being or firing or threatening them is going to make them do better the next time. Instead, what we have to do is we have to focus on systems. We have to focus on processes in order to make sure that people will be able to make the right choices because it's the easiest choice available to them, because the tooling does the right thing out of the box. And if you don't have this kind of a culture where there is no blame, what winds up happening is people don't actually give you honest information. People will lie to you about what happened, and then you won't actually be able to fix the set of failures that resulted in an outage. The second key area that is really important culturally to SRE is the idea of managing the amount of operational work that you do. Because what happens is that if you don't have a bound on this, you will wind up with the percentage of your time spent doing rote manual work. It will grow to 100% of your time. It will swallow all available time. Because of the fact that our services grow in size over time, and that unless you put a check on that, you're going to find that you're spending more and more time doing that manual work every single time your service increases in size. However, you can't necessarily, nor should you, reduce the amount of time that you spend doing operational work to zero. Why is this? This may seem a little bit counterintuitive. The reason is that if you don't have hands-on experience with your systems, you're going to wind up building the wrong things. You're going to wind up solving problems that you don't actually have or neglecting problems that are in your stack. And this is a common failure pattern that happens when you separate product development from operations because you don't have the right set of people responsible for the services. So this gives you the ability to know what to automate if you do a little bit of manual work. So what do we define as kind of operational manual work? Fundamentally, it's things that scale in the size of your service. Common flags for this include, are you doing something by hand? Is it something that you're doing over and over and over again? And is it something that requires none of your actual human judgment? Is it something that a robot could have done for you? And is it break fix? Does it return you back to the same state you were before rather than resulting in a lasting improvement to your service? So these are things that we think about in terms of saying we want to spend somewhere between 30 and 40% of our time doing toil and no more than that, and not less than 10%. Another key area of culture is building the right set of skills on your team, not necessarily in one person. Making sure that you have both people who understand software engineering and computer science really well, because all of our systems are built upon solving algorithmic problems, but also people who understand how do systems fail at scale? How do all of the moving pieces fit together? Because those two are disjoint skills that are not necessarily combined in the same person. So you have to make sure that you're facilitating having teams that have both these skill sets in order to have the right set of people to advise and consult on making sure that your services run well. And finally, I think it's really important to make sure that your SREs are empowered, that they actually have the ability to push back and say, you know what? I don't think that service is ready to launch, or I can't take on this service right now because I'm too overloaded. And if you give me that service, that's going to push me over 50% of my time doing ops work, and I'll become less and less effective over time. And it also means that you have to be able to say, you know what? We have had too many breakages recently. We need to slow down. Because otherwise, you're not actually doing SRE, right? You're not actually building an engineering organization. So now, hopefully, I think it's a little bit clearer. How does SRE align with DevOps? And the answer is each of the five pillars of DevOps is something that SRE has a concrete way that it thinks that you should do it. For instance, we think that the way to reduce your organizational silos is not necessarily to put SREs on every product development team, but instead to make sure that we're all using the same tools, we're all using the same frameworks in order to manage our services. And that the way that we accept failure as normal is through saying that we're going to have blameless postmortems, and that we're going to define reliability targets, and that's the error budget, which I'll talk about in a minute. We also reduce the cost of failure by making sure that we're doing gradual rollouts, and that we automate our common cases in the course of eliminating our toil, and that we measure how much time are we spending on toil. We measure what's our actual reliability and how does it compare to our targets. And that's why that I say that SRE and DevOps are completely compatible with each other. So that was kind of a little bit of a 15-minute whirlwind tour of how does SRE work, what are the kind of fundamentals of SRE. But what I want to tell you about next is really the core technical principle that underlies SRE. And that's called a service level objective. So how did we come up with the idea of an SLO? It came from the realization by Ben Trainor-Sloss, the founder of SRE at Google, who is currently the vice president of 24x7 at Google. And his realization was that 100% is the wrong reliability target for basically everything. And that is because of the fact that there are diminishing returns to improving the reliability of your service. For instance, how many of you have one of these, a cell phone? Right? How many of you use phone apps? Okay. How many of you have phone apps that rely on internet connectivity to work correctly? Does the internet connectivity on your phone always work? Does it always work on the subway in between stops? Does it always work when there's a flash mob and more people turn up in Central Park from Pokemon Go than the network can handle? Right? So it turns out that you can make your service 5 or 6 nines available, but if people are relying on a cellular network to access your service, they're not ever going to notice the improvement. So you're dumping money down the drain if you try to do that because you're not focusing on where the bottleneck is. That it's exponentially more expensive to add additional nines of reliability, and those are frequently nines that your users will never notice because some other factor is the critical bottleneck. So as a result, this means that there's a trade-off, right? That reliability is a product feature just like any other product feature. And it's something that the product managers and SREs have to work together on to decide, what is my target? And it can't be 100% because we know that users in practice have reliability demands that are less than 100%. So we have to say, what's our availability target? For instance, 3.5 nines or 4 nines or 5 nines. And then we can say, what's the remaining amount of time, right? If I say that my service is 99.9% reliable as its target, that means that I have 0.1% of the time that my service can be down. And that gives me a budget of errors to work with. And I can compare to my actual measured reliability and compare to my actual number of errors that I'm observing. And then that gives me a really powerful control loop for being able to utilize that budget. When I'm spending too much of it, I can slow down. And when I'm spending not enough of it, I can afford to take more risks. I can afford to be more agile. And when you do this, you get some really great benefits out of it. The primary one is that thing about shared tooling, of shared measurement, right? That everyone is on the same page about what is our goal. We are all working together to make our service achieve that goal, rather than being antagonistic with each other, rather than having competing interests. And it also means that there may not even need to be SREs associated with a service. If a product development team picks SLOs, they can manage that to the on their own. But that if someone picks a goal that's wildly unrealistic, they're going to wind up violating their SLO really often, and then they'll get paged all the time, right? And then they'll realize maybe this is not the right target. And at the end of the day, this means that we have a crisp idea of what does user success mean to us, and are we actually doing a good job of it? So in practice, how do we actually think about this? Well, I talked about time earlier, right? I could say that I'm going to look at the number of good minutes divided by the number of total minutes, right? And that's, to some extent, it's easy to think about, right? In that you can say, you know, I'm going to ask a monitoring vendor to go and ping my server or fetch just the homepage every 30 seconds. And if it's up, it's up. And if it's down, then I'll mark that period as bad, right? But unfortunately, this doesn't really work that well in a microservice environment or in a distributed scaled environment because of the fact that we wind up having partial outages. Or we wind up having outages that are more complex than is the home page directly loadable. But fortunately, there's a better approach than this. And it's a little bit more sophisticated. It says instead, we want to measure the proportion of good interactions with our service. Did the user accomplish what they were trying to do? For instance, on Etsy's website, a user might want to have a workflow of searching for a product that they want to buy, finding that product, adding it to their cart, and checking out. And they might have a certain tolerance for how long they're willing to wait for each of those steps and for the journey in total. So therefore, I can look, instead of at, did the Etsy homepage respond, I can instead look at, was a user, each user, able to complete their transaction in a short enough window of time? And that tells us how many real users the service is working for or not. And it lets us address these distributed request response services, right? It lets us say, is this working well enough in a state where some of the time you may have a small fraction of users who are degraded? So I'm sure many of you have seen the chart of nines before, right? Where you might have, for instance, a 99.9% reliable service that is allowed to have up to 43 minutes of downtime per month. Or potentially, in an environment where you look at these user interactions rather than time, you might be able to fail 10% of your requests for 430 minutes per month because of the fact that we look across all of the user requests across that entire month. So the service level objective is a really powerful tool for setting what our targets are for ourselves and measuring whether our users are happy. And we can define in even more detail what a successful user journey looks like, right? We can say our service level indicator is our mechanism of bucketing either a period of time in the naive approach or a user interaction in the sophisticated approach as good or not. Was the interaction successful? And then we can have our service level objective, which says this is the proportion of these interactions or periods of time that we expect to be successful in order for our service to be deemed good enough. And finally, you may have service level agreements, which are governing what are you going to do if you break them. For instance, pay money back to your sellers or pay money back to your customers. And you typically want to set your service level agreements more leniently than your service level objectives so that your alerting and your SLOs will be broken before you actually wind up having customers screaming at you. So I've talked about kind of the theory of SLOs, but now I want to talk about how do these actually translate into practices, right? How do I actually define a good SLO? It turns out that for a complete definition of an SLO, it can potentially take a few hours to multiple days of discussion between different teams. So I'm not going to be able to walk you through your exact situations, but instead I'll hopefully be able to give you a taste of what this looks like. So the key thing, as I mentioned, is deciding what makes users happy, what makes users sad, right? What's a good user interaction, what's a bad user interaction? And also figuring out what metrics do we have available to us? What's correlated with users' experiences? For instance, I have two potential metrics that I could use in a service level indicator displayed on screen right now. The one on the left is one that I assert is a bad choice, and the one on the right I assert is a good choice. Why is that? Well, let's suppose that I have a period of time in which I know from the customer support hotline that users were complaining. And what I can do is I can say, okay, is there a common pattern to my metrics during the period in which users were complaining? In this period here, I can pretty clearly see that there is actually a pretty good correlation with my outage. That when the outage was happening, this metric dipped below a certain level. Whereas over here, I have a whole large amount of variance in the metric, right? The metric is bouncing up and down, and there's no simple threshold that I can set to distinguish a good experience from a bad experience. So as a result, I need to make sure that I can get a good signal-to-noise ratio out of my metrics. And that sometimes may mean coming up with new metrics rather than reusing existing metrics. How many of you have metrics like the bad one on the left, like CPU load that you're tracking? Right? You probably don't want to rely on those for your alerting. Instead, you probably want things, which I'll talk about later, such as your error rates or your latencies. So there are a couple of different categories of things that you might want to measure in defining the success of your user journeys. Some of you may have request response interactive services. Others of you may have data processing, kind of batch workloads. And yet others of you may have storage workloads where holding on to your user's data and being able to return it really matters, as was very luckily foreshadowed. Thank you. So let's talk first about request response. What makes for a good request response service level indicator? There are three key things that you can think about there: availability, latency, and quality. Availability primarily refers to whether or not the request succeeded. Did it return an HTTP 200 or did it return a 500 error code? Latency talks about the proportion of requests that are served faster than a given threshold. If you know that your users abandon their carts when it takes more than 2 seconds to add to their carts, maybe that's a good threshold to use for latency, for instance. Because even if it returns successfully HTTP 200 after 5 seconds, that's probably not a good experience for the user. And then finally, quality might matter. For instance, maybe you have the ability to return partial results from your search corpus. You might say that it's OK as long as we search 99% of our corpus to emit results from the remaining 1% of the corpus. So thinking about what's your quality threshold? And it's important to have service level indicators, not for just one of these, but potentially for two or all three of these, in order to be able to really accurately assess whether or not you're detecting breakages that your users are suffering through. There's also data processing workloads, right? And their latency is there, but you'll also find that there's coverage and freshness. Did we actually complete processing on most of our data? Did we actually update our data fast enough? And did we actually have data ingested into the pipeline make it to production within a short enough window of time? And for durability, or for storage, durability really matters. Can I reread the data that I wrote originally? Do I have a plan in order to make sure that, should there be some kind of outage, that I can restore that data in a fast enough manner and in a reliable enough manner? In general, we like to phrase SLIs as proportions of events, as I mentioned earlier, or if you have to, proportions of time. So typically, a service level indicator is some kind of percentage, and a service level objective is setting a threshold on that percentage, saying over a period of time, what fraction of my interactions are going to be good. So typically, you will have 1 to 3 service level indicators per user journey. And even if your service is really complicated, even if you have a variety of different pathways, for instance, being able to view seller profiles and being able to browse the homepage, you might just decide to make buckets. You might say, you know what? Viewing the homepage and viewing a seller's profile are fundamentally the same category of interaction in that it's a search type query. And you might be able to say, you know what? I don't care what specific kind of query it was. What matters is the user's expectation. For instance, I might say that viewing the Etsy homepage and viewing a seller's profile page are both interactive queries that expect to complete in fast enough, like within 500 milliseconds. But it might be OK for someone updating the list of items that they're selling in their store. It might be OK for a write transaction to take a little bit longer. Or it might be OK for it to take 5 seconds from the time that we confirm we received your item to upload to actually having it visible in the search index. Right? These are all different kinds of buckets that you can group queries into when setting service level indicators so you don't have to worry about managing 200 different SLIs and SLOs. What are the choices that we might make? Right? How do we actually define an SLI? So we might actually start off with a high-level description. Like, a seller's profile page should load successfully, and it should load quickly enough. But you might actually need to define, what does success mean, right? What does it mean for the page to load successfully? And where am I measuring it from? And where am I starting and stopping my timing measurements? So that requires us to make detailed technical decisions and potentially revisit them down the line about how we're measuring these things. For instance, we might say that we're trying to measure the fraction of HTTP GET requests for the profile URLs that have a certain HTTP response code measured from our load balancer. But it turns out that there are a lot of different variations. For instance, I might choose to measure instead of from the load balancer, from client-side JavaScript. Or I might choose to decide that a 400 error is actually not OK. Right? These are all varying choices that I could make that I'd have to document. So at the end of the day, when we have a service level objective, this means that we have aggregated together our service level indicators and set targets on them. And this lets us go ahead and set these actual practical thresholds. For instance, we might say that we want 99.9% of profile page loads to be correct over 30 days. And when you're setting these things, it's important to think about what are you actually needing from your, what do your users actually expect from you, right? What causes a user to abandon Etsy? What causes a user to abandon their transaction? But you also need to think about what are people happy with as an initial starting point, right? Rather than trying to imagine these things completely from scratch, you can just start from your historical performance and use that as a baseline. And if too many people are complaining and your business is losing money, maybe you need to be more stringent. The converse to this is that when you have a situation where you're delivering much better performance than your users actually need, they may wind up expecting it and being unhappy because of the fact that you're changing the behavior that they're seeing. So it's important to continuously evaluate what your business requirements are and change your service level objectives as you go. For instance, reevaluating every 6 to 12 months. So we've talked a great deal about how do you actually numerically set SLOs. So hopefully this gives you some ideas as to how you might start implementing these measurements inside of your organization. But there's the other half to it, right? It's giving them teeth. What do you actually do when your service level objective is in danger? So we're going to talk about this next. And I think that what's important to the idea of a service level indicator and objective is that the context of your performance really matters. That if you have a well-defined SLO and good records of your historical performance, it will tell you, is it OK to serve 100% errors for 30 minutes right now? Or would that potentially violate my SLO? Is it OK for me to serve 1% errors for 5 days? At the end of the day, what matters is not necessarily, is my hard disk full, but instead, can my users actually use my service? Because if you over-alert your team, they're going to turn off their pagers, or they're going to be really groggy and grumpy, and that doesn't really help anyone have an improved service. And it's not just hard disk full. These are real things I've seen teams set up alerts on. What if the CPU load on one server is too high? Or what if your Paxos quorum changed? Or what if an individual task or replica restarted? Or what if the queue length on your Kafka queue is too long? Or you flipped the wrong bits, or your health checks failed, or the database became unreachable? Does this really matter? What actually matters is your service level objective, because that's the thing measuring your user happiness. Did too many users receive HTTP 500s? That's the number that you actually care about, and not each of these individual potential root causes. So in practice, how can we actually track these things? It's important to have a burndown graph, right? It's important to have a list of how much error budget do I have remaining. And I'll walk you through this. I know this is a little bit confusing. So let's talk about a sample set of outages, right? Let's talk about a large outage where I had a large drop in the percentage of requests to my service that succeeded in a short length of time. So that reflects in four different ways, right? That I have much less error budget remaining, that I have instantaneously much less success, and that my SLI has gone red for a short period of time. But eventually, these outages do roll off the end of our rolling measurement window, right? That I might have a previous outage that happened more than 30 days ago, so I periodically get error budget back as I go. There's also a different kind of outage that is more long-lasting, right? Where you might have Your SLO saying that you need to have 99% of your requests succeed, but if you're serving 1.1% errors over many days, that will cause your error budget to slowly, slowly, slowly get eroded over time. And that lines up looking very, very bad if you're looking at a binary. Is my SLO instantaneously appearing to be met if the pattern were abstracted out over time? But you actually have to look at the math, right? You have to look at how much error budget am I burning by serving these errors. And this fundamentally relates to the concept of slow burn versus fast burn, right? Am I consuming weeks of my budget in the span of hours, or am I spending slightly more than my intended long-term steady state of errors? And both of these things are things that we care about if we're going to defend our error budget. And the best way to react to them is to be confident but responsive, right? To think about how many errors am I allowed to serve? Am I burning that much faster than I intend to the point that I need to wake a human up, to the point that they need to respond within minutes? Because if you don't do that, you wind up spending your entire error budget before you even react. On the converse side, if you're trying to detect something that's slowly eroding your error budget, it takes time to get statistical confidence. So you wind up having to wait multiple days, which is fine because it's not going to drain your error budget overnight, in order to make sure that you're avoiding false alarms. And then when it does trip, you can have someone look at it the next business day. So what does this look like in practice? Well, we wind up having thresholds, right? We wind up saying, we'll look at the trailing 1 hour or 3 hours of errors, and we'll compare to what we're allowed to spend in that time. And if I dramatically overspend that by a factor of 5 or 7, or even that I overspend it by a factor of 5 or 7 within the past 10 or 20 minutes, I need to wake someone up. Or in the slow case, where I might need to look back for multiple days, look back 3 days and see, am I serving more than 10.5 errors per second average over those 3 days when the error rate that I'm allowed is 10? Then maybe I need to go and file a ticket, right? File a JIRA ticket. Or even if it's spent in 1 day, if it's bad enough, I may want to find out that way. And the reason that we do this is because we need a control loop, right? Like, we need to be able to intervene when our error budget is in danger, which requires knowing when it's in danger. And when it is potentially in danger, we need to know, what are we doing as SREs, right? How are we making sure that we're defending the service of the users? We have to communicate. So I'm going to tell you about 4 different ways that we may react to a given set of outages. So we're going to start off with the simple case of something happens, bad release happens, we roll it back. Then we'll talk about actually breaking your SLO, breaking that promise to your users. And then what happens if you're unable to fix it over the course of multiple different months? So let's talk about the situation where my pager goes off because of the fact that I pushed a bad release, or someone else pushed a bad release, right? And that we broke half of our users for about an hour. Is that okay? Is that something that we're willing to tolerate? Well, our SLO says that 99.9% of user journeys have to be happy over 30 days. So if we go look at this chart, right, and we go 99.9% 30 days, we can see that we're allowed 43 minutes of complete downtime, or potentially 86 minutes of half downtime, right? So I've spent effectively 30 minutes of complete downtime, which means that I have 13 minutes of error budget left, and I need to be cautious at least for the next month until that rolls off of the window of time that my users remember. And it may be okay, right? I can continue pushing releases, and I may want to implement some other mitigations, like maybe I want to roll back faster than an hour, or maybe I want to test at less than 50%, right? So let's go and talk about the next case. So we've already had this 1 hour 50% outage in the past 30 days, and another outage happens. We did the thing where we implemented automatic rollbacks, and we implemented having testing on a smaller percentage of the fleet, so we only broke 20% of users. But now we've had 30 bad minutes and 12 bad minutes, so now what's happened? We've exhausted our error budget, right? Our error budget says we have 43 minutes. We spent 42 minutes. That's not really good. So this means that we need to bring in additional help to defend our SLO, right? That we need to actually say, you know what? You're not pushing any more feature releases, right? The system is in too unstable of a state. We need to wait and give customers some time to recover rather than saying Etsy is always down. We can do things like deploying fixes for the underlying issues relatively quickly because we do want to mitigate risk as our first priority. But it's important to be thoughtful about, is this going to make my situation better or worse with my error budget? So that's typically usually as far as it gets in a mature SRE team, where you don't persistently have your SLO being broken, but you instead react and say, you know what, we're running low, let's stop doing releases. But what happens if the SLO is unsustainable? What happens if now your service is scaling up and scaling up and scaling up, and there's a bottleneck? And there's a bottleneck that's causing 0.2% of your requests to consistently time out. There's no rollback. You can't say, hey, by the way, I'd like to roll back my user base to half of what it is right now. That's probably not going to be a good strategy, right? So we have to think instead about what are we going to do to avoid paging ourselves to death? What are we going to do for the long-term health of the site? Because we can't have an error budget that's 0.1% of our total requests and be serving 0.2% errors, right? So we have to prioritize long-term fixes, right? We have to say, you know what? That feature that you wanted to work on over the next 3 months, we have to set that aside. We have to re-architect the system, right? And we potentially can do things like taking out other sources of risk. Like maybe we don't do A/B experiments for a little while. Or maybe we have additional money we can throw at the problem where we can just provision that machine, that single point of failure, to be extra, extra beefy. But sometimes it's just not possible, right? Sometimes you wind up having a service that is architected in not quite the right way, where your alerts are constantly going off and there's no way to fix the problem. What do you do then? That involves a really difficult conversation. That's where executive support for SRE really matters, where you can say, you know what, we're going to prioritize doing year-long projects in order to completely redesign this service. Or we're going to change our service level objective. Like maybe we've set the wrong target, or maybe our target is not in line with something that we can actually defend. Or maybe it's time to hand back the pager. Maybe it's time to turn it back over to the product development team because there's a better use of our time as SREs. So in summary, when you have an issue that's transient, you can mitigate, right? And it's normal for outages to sometimes happen. But if you wind up running really low on your error budget, then you do have to take a step back and say, we're going to stop doing releases. We're going to slow down until we get past the window. But if you have repeated violations, you need to follow up on it. You need to have a plan. And if you have chronic violations, then that involves a conversation in order to make sure that everyone's on the same page about what's involved in supporting this service. But you don't have to guess. You don't have to wait until your SLO is broken all the time, right? You can actually say, I'm going to tally up what known risks I have and see, is the service level objective realistic, or do we have some work we need to do before this feature launches or before this service launches? Because it doesn't make sense to launch something that you know isn't going to work, that's not fit for purpose. So I've talked a little bit about kind of the stick side of the carrot on the stick, the stick side of SRE and error budgets, but how do error budgets help you move faster? For that, it's important to understand kind of graphically, what does the error budget look like? How might we spend it? So normally if you have a service, right, we design our service in order to have a certain level of reliability, and we do some amount of manual work to keep it in line with our system parameters. And sometimes we get lucky, or sometimes we don't, and the luck is missing. So we want our service to be reliable enough and within our target range, even if luck is not on our side. So what we have remaining in that space is a space of acceptable errors. And if we get lucky, then we can potentially do experimentation rather than just let that error budget go to waste. So we may do more A/B tests, right? We may go ahead and do disaster recovery tests. But what happens if our service is less reliable than we designed it to be? In that case, what we need to do is that we wind up spending a bunch of time firefighting, and we still can't achieve the SLO if luck is not on our side. And in that situation, we have to say things like, you know, you're going to stop releases. You're going to redesign the service. And when you do that, you get back to that healthy state. That's what I meant by the control loop earlier, that SRE is really about enforcing boundaries on our services to make them run reliably. So SRE is a combination of these three different things, right? It's about knowing what the reliability improvements we need to make to our systems are and doing them. About doing the operational work that we need within reason to keep the service within our SLO range, and setting What is our SLO? Setting what our targets are. Those three things very much make up SRE. So in conclusion, these are the things that we talked about today. We talked about what SRE is, right? Why do we do it? What problem does it solve? We talked about the key concept, the key principle behind SRE, which is service level objective and error budget. We talked about how you might define a service level objective knowing what kind of service you have, and how you actually enforce them, how you actually have a control loop on your service, and how you can use the error budget as a metric to decide, am I free to take risks? Am I free to experiment right now? The message I want you to take away is that you don't have to scale up the size of your operational organization as you scale up the number of machines that you run. That if you're automating things, if you're engineering things correctly so that they operate well, that you can scale without having to increase that number of people. And that you don't have to have distinct development and operations teams that are at each other's throats. That instead, if you have common metrics like the error budget, then you really get the flexibility to decide on the fly, which one of these do I need to prioritize right now? If you're defining an SLO, it's important to have any SLO rather than not measuring anything. Because if you're not measuring it, you don't know about it, and your users will be hurting, and you'll discover outages through your customer support team rather than through your monitoring. So define what matters to your users and measure and track it. And as you go, you can do these things that I mentioned. You can add these burn alerts to see, is my error budget in danger? And turn off all of those noisy alerts that are on CPU load or on hard disk fullness. And that you need to empower your teams to do the right thing when error budgets are in danger. And potentially, you can measure more user journeys, right? You can expand this to more and more of your organization, but you have to pick a starting point. You have to pick somewhere to start measuring. And over time, you can do more sophisticated things like saying, this is the fraction of my error budget that I allocate to the database. This is the fraction of my error budget that I allocate to the front-end team. But those are more sophisticated. What matters is kind of at a high-level organizational perspective, do you know whether your users are happy with you or not? So there are some additional resources. The first two are available for free at google.com/SRE. And all three of these are available through the O'Reilly store as well at shop.oreilly.com. So you can really do this, right? You can really iterate and make your operational practice better. And as long as you have SLOs, you'll be on a path to success. We also have the customer reliability engineering team, which is my current team, where we help people who are GCP customers do these things, where we help you decide, is this product fit for purpose? Is it actually going to achieve the reliability levels that we need? Or does something need to change? Are we instrumenting things in the same way so that the support team can find out about outages at Google at the same time as you're discovering outages? And how do we know whether or not an outage is fixed? Because we can just see your monitoring. And we can help people prepare for events like Black Friday, right? We can help people make sure their systems are shipshape before a critical period happens. So thank you. I know that was long, and it's hard to hold attention for 45 minutes. So I reckon we have about 10 minutes for questions if people would like to step up to that microphone there.
I'll go first.
Pick up the microphone or turn it towards you.
Sure. Hello. So you talked just in this last slide about inherent tensions between software development teams and classic ops teams. But what I haven't heard as much is, what about the relationship between product development teams and SREs? And how does that relationship work? And how does it avoid, like in a little bit more detail, the tension between ops and engineering?
I think that there is such a thing as healthy tension. If everyone is on the same team and we're all trying to achieve the same goal, it becomes a lot easier to be aligned. I think the other thing that helps make this problem easier at Google is the notion that, number one, SREs are scarce. SREs can be assigned to where the need is greatest. And therefore, that if a team doesn't want to cooperate with SREs, they can kind of keep both pieces, right? They can work on it themselves. And also that product development teams pay for their own SREs, that product development vice presidents and directors have a choice to make between, am I going to spend this headcount on an SRE or on a product developer? So if we're not doing an effective job, we'll wind up having the product development team pull back their service and say, you know what, I'd rather have product developers, and we can assign those SREs to do something else, right? So kind of those control loops really help make it clear when an SRE team is doing their job well, when a relationship is damaged, and kind of help us have these conversations more at the management level rather than at the individual contributor level. So you won't wind up having SREs that are grumpy at their product development software engineer counterpart. You'll potentially wind up having two different directors that are talking to each other saying, I don't think this is working. What do we need to do to fix it?
Hey, the last slide had a wheels of misfortune. What do you mean by that?
So what do we mean by wheel of misfortune? A wheel of misfortune is a mechanism of training people in order to deal with crisis situations without actually having a crisis. So it comes from the idea that we might literally spin a wheel to pick which scenario or pick which volunteer is going to receive that scenario and work through the mock issue themselves. So when we do a wheel of misfortune that's joint with another company, we might invite engineers from both sides to sit together in one room and role play what happens if it's Black Friday and Etsy's MySQL instances die. What are we going to do, right? And really talk through and role play it before it actually potentially happens so that we'll know and make sure that our playbooks are in solid shape, that our lines of communication are good.
Yeah, thanks.
Hello. The question is, how do you implement, say, chaos engineering at the end, that experimentation part, or would you suggest anything? Like, I will fail my system randomly, so it will affect.
Yes, the question was, how do you actually spend your experimentation budget? There is a very rich field in chaos engineering, right? So we can choose to randomly fail requests. And in fact, one very commonly used bedrock service at Google has had to turn itself off for 10 minutes every 3 months in order to remind people that if we didn't have an outage for 10 minutes this quarter, that you're going to have an outage so that you don't falsely rely on that promise, right? But it's often possible to do less kind of wasteful things with that, right? Like you might decide to increase the percentage of replicas that a product developer can push on green to, or can just push an experiment to anytime they like, right? That's potentially a good thing that will improve your ability to iterate your product quickly if a product developer can push to any instance.
Hi. Does the SLO need to be a absolute value, or can it be a variable over a time? Taking your Black Friday example, if your if SLO is based on error count or error rate, for example, and that's over time more relevant during the season than not, how do you correlate that?
Yes, this is why it really is a better solution to have your SLOs based off of number of requests or interactions than over time. Because during Black Friday, you have a higher number of requests, so therefore the proportion of those requests that succeed or fail matters more to your overall rolling window than potentially during a slower time in that rolling 30 or 60 or 90 day window. So otherwise, you do wind up having to do these complicated gymnastics, right, of saying, you know, if it's an outage on a weekend at 3 a.m., then maybe it doesn't matter, right, because we've decided that's our lowest period of traffic, or maybe we have people that only use things during business hours. So the simpler way that avoids all of that is, in fact, to say, I'm going to look at the rolling window of queries.
Hello. You talked a bit earlier about toil management. What effective way have you found to measure toil, and what kind of actions should be taken if toil is excessive?
We do a few things to measure toil. The first one of which is random sampling. So we'll randomly sample a subset of SREs every week. That way we kind of cover the entire organization about once a quarter, and we'll say, how much of your past week did you spend doing toil? And that way we can kind of get an aggregate loose measurement based on people's gut feelings. But there's also another mechanism, which is to batch toil together, right? If you know that responding to tickets from users or tickets or non-urgent system alerts is something that interrupts people's attention, right? Because you have to context switch away from your software development project. Maybe it's better to have the on-caller do it, or the secondary on-caller do it, so that only one person gets interrupted rather than five or six people getting round robin. And if you make that person's full-time job, then it's easy to see, okay, right, like the secondary on-caller is on toil 100%, the on-caller is on toil 100%, our on-call rotation is eight people, therefore we're spending 25% of our time on toil, right? That makes that math really, really simple. Obviously, there always is looseness in that, right? You always have some amount of small amount of toilet that spills over, and that's why it's important to do the surveys. But kind of grouping the toilets together is both effective at measuring it and effective at reducing it, because it's easier to context switch a bunch of 30-minute tickets than it is to get interrupted from your month-long project by a 30-minute interrupt.
Thank you.
I think I can take two more questions.
So you talked about SLO measured as a fraction of requests versus time. Do you know of any open source tools that measure SLO as a fraction of requests? Because most of them measure as a fraction of time.
Not necessarily in the realm of open source, although I know that a colleague of mine has been working on a Prometheus proof of concept that will do SLOs for you with some pre-written rules. If you're looking to track requests and you're already a customer of Stackdriver, Stackdriver SLO does exist. It's a product in early access that does exactly this computation for you out of the box. I'm working with other companies such as Datadog and New Relic in order to make sure that their tooling supports doing this as well. Because we don't really care at the end of the day which monitoring product we use. We care that you use something that helps you accurately measure your service. Final question. All right, you can find me afterwards. Thank you so much for coming.
To defy